Hello everyone, this is Michel Birler. This is the last topic of our course on optimization and simulation. We will talk about multi-objective optimization. Multi-objective optimization is useful when there is a need to optimize several objective functions at the same time. And actually, in most practical applications, these multiple objectives are usually conflicting. It means that if you improve one of them, it may deteriorate the others. Some typical examples, so in transportation, if you want to maximize the level of services, usually it will cost more. If you increase the number of buses, or if you increase the number of trains on a specific line, you will increase the level of service, but you will increase the cost. And the objective is to minimize the cost. In portfolio optimization in finance, you want to maximize the return, but you also want to minimize the risk, and these two objectives are conflicting. If you organize a survey, if you want to design a survey, well, you want to maximize the information that you will get from the respondents, but you also want to minimize the number of questions because it's a burden for the respondents that may deteriorate the quality of the response. And the list is long of concrete applications where the various objectives that are meaningful are conflicting. We will write a multi-objective optimization problem by defining a vector capital F that contains all the capital P objectives that we are interested in. So X is the vector of decision variables. It must belong to a feasible set. So these are the constraints. And the capital F takes X, the vector of Rn, as an input and provides a vector of Rp, which is the vector of objectives that we are interested in. So let's start by some definitions. A key concept in the context of multi-objective optimization is the concept of dominance. So consider two solutions, x1 and x2, belonging to Rn. We will say that x1 is dominating x2 if two things happen. One, x1 is no worse in any of the objectives. So the value of the objective function for x1 is less or equal to the value of the objective function for x2 for all the objective functions. And second, there must be at least one objective for which x1 is strictly better. We will use the following notation. So this means that x1 dominates x2. What are the properties of this dominance operator? First, it's not reflexive. So a solution X does not dominate itself. It's not symmetric. If X dominates Y, it does not imply that Y dominates X. It makes sense, right? Instead, if X dominates Y, it implies that Y does not dominate X. It is transitive. If X dominates Y and Y dominates Z, it implies that X dominates Z. And something important is that it's not complete. So for two different solutions X and Y, it may happen that X does not dominate Y and Y does not dominate X. And we'll see examples of this. Let's consider here an example where we have two objectives that we want to minimize. So here the x-axis corresponds to the objective F1, and the second axis corresponds to the second objective F2, and we consider four vectors, x1, x2, x3, and x4, and then we try to look at the dominance relationship between these solutions. If you look at x3 and x2, x3 happens to be strictly better than X2 in both objectives. So it clearly dominates X2. If we now compare X3 and X1, we see that X3 is better than X1 in both objectives, F1 and F2, and it's strictly better for F2. So it verifies the definition of dominance. And X3 dominates X1. Let's now compare X1 and X4. Well, X1 is better than X4 for objective 1, strictly better. And X4 is better than X1 for objective 2, strictly better. So in this case, we cannot say that X1 dominates X4 because X4 is better for objective F2. And we cannot say that X4 dominates X1 because X1 is better than X4 for objective F1. So this is an example of the non-completeness of this dominance relationship. So X1 and X4 are such that none of them is dominating the other one. In the context of multi-objective optimization, we need to redefine the concept of optimality. And the concept that is introduced is called the Pareto optimality. The definition is the following. A vector X star, feasible vector X star, will be said to be Pareto optimal if there is no feasible solution over the X star that dominates X star. So the intuition is that X will be Pareto optimal if there is no objective that can be improved without degrading at least one of the others. Another concept that can be considered is the concept of weak Pareto optimality. In this case, a vector X star, feasible vector X star, will be said to be weakly Pareto optimal if there is no feasible solution that improves all the objectives of the problem. And the two concepts are related, so it's a weaker version of Pareto optimality. If we denote by P star the set of Pareto optimal solutions of the problem, by WP star the set of weakly Pareto optimal solutions of the problem, then we have this relationship that P star is included in WP star, which is included in the set of feasible solutions. So it means that all the Pareto optimal solutions are weakly optimal, but not in the other direction. Let's take again our example with two objectives and the four feasible solution. In this case, X3 is Pareto optimal. Indeed, it's not dominated by any other points. And X1, X3, and X4, the three of them are weakly Pareto optimal. Indeed, there is no feasible point that strictly improves F1 and F2 for the three of them. So this illustrates the fact that P star is included in WP star using the definition that we have introduced in the previous slide. In the context of Pareto optimality, we will call the Pareto optimal set the set that we just defined, so the set of axes that are such that they are not dominated by any feasible point, and the corresponding values of the objective function, so the vector of values of the objective function, is called the Pareto frontier. I have a similar plot here than the previous one, so two objectives, F1 and F2, that we want to minimize. And I have here a polyhedron as feasible set, capital F. And the Pareto frontier is represented in a thick line here. So it contains all the points that are Pareto optimal, in the sense that there is no feasible point that dominates them.